Yes, he did. He turned it. He turned my sorrow into dancing. And he turned my bad times into joy. I wanted to let that music play just a little bit because truly that is the testimony of my life, that just what the devil meant for evil, God has turned it around for my good. This is another awesome and amazing day that our God has made, and I will rejoice and be glad. And I am so happy, enthusiastic, and overjoyed of the fact that the Lord has been so gracious and kind to me to give me life, that life more abundantly, and that abundant life now has eternal life. And so I have no reason to be down, depressed, upset, down in the dumps, because God has given me life, and he's given me life. He has everything contained in that life. And so I lift up my eyes to the hills from which cometh my help, knowing that my help cometh from the Lord. Can I encourage you that no matter whatever it is that you're going through, because you have life, you have a reason to give God praise and to give God glory and to give God thanks, because God is turning things around for your good. Yes, your bills might be tough, and yes, there might be pain in your body. Yes, you might be having economic and financial and even relational challenges, but you're still alive. Amen. And if you're still alive, you got time, you got grace, you got mercy to begin to rectify and turn those things around. And there's a lot of people with a whole lot more money, more like prestige, that are not in the land of the living, and they wish that they had the day that you have. And so can I get you to do anything? It'd be to clear your mind, your thoughts, and your ideas, and to give God praise and glory that you are still alive. You might be unemployed, but you're still alive. You might be homeless, but you are still alive. And so you got to learn to start off with thanking God for what you do have. Said on last week that David was probably in the same place. He started seeing the prosperity of the wicked. Things weren't working out the way that he thought they should. And so he wanted to complain to God when he went to complain. But he began to think of the goodness of God that he had, as the Bible says, in the land of the living. And his complaint turned into a praise. And I would that every day that you will ignore the evil one who wants to show you what's bad, what's not good, what you're up against, what's not right, who's against you. And you understand that God's grace and mercy has been extended to you, that he's given you life. And you then take that and turn it into a praise and glory and magnification of the great and awesome God I have. And so always practice that. Practice that. We sing a song at my church that says, "Hallelujah, anyhow." Amen. I'll never let my burdens get me down. That when my trials come my way, I'll lift my hands to God and say, "Hallelujah, anyhow." So anytime I hear good, uplifting praise music, I just want to dance and praise. And one day, we're just going to come in there and we're going to dance. We're going to praise God and shout. Can't do that today, but we're going to do it one day. Well, you're used to seeing my face by now. My name is Pastor Philip White of the Regenerated Church. I am the guest host today, once again, on the Mother's Cry, thanking God for this awesome door and this privilege that I have to come in to sit and to talk with you and to come into your homes and on your jobs or wherever it is that you might be listening or watching this program. It's tape delayed sometimes on YouTube, and so somebody's listening to it later, will be listening to it later than the time that it's actually recorded. I'm grateful to God that I have this opportunity to come and for the Lord to use me and to speak through me, that it might hopefully be a blessing and uplifting and development of your spiritual walk with him. Outside of giving God thanks and praise for this opportunity, we always want to thank the founder of A Mother's Cry, Evangelist Shirley Knight Harris, who is the woman of God that God, by his spirit, birthed this vision to. She carried it to fruition, and she now stands believing God that God's going to do the great and awesome work that he started doing in this program. And we're asking you to continue to pray for Mother Harris. Regrettably, on last week, her husband passed, and he went from labor to reward. And so we want you to continue to lift her up and her family up, that God will continue just to encourage and strengthen her. The Bible clearly lets us know that to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. He also comforts those that are here by telling us that he will never leave us nor forsake us, that he'll be with us always, even until the end of the age. And so, Evangelist Harris, the Mother's Cry audience, and definitely me, we are praying for you that God will just strengthen you and your family and all the extended loved ones as you have walked through this valley and this shadow, knowing that God is going to be with you. As always, we like to ask God's blessings on this program and over our time of gathering. And then we always extend our prayers to our founder. And so let's do that. Father, in the name of Jesus, we just thank you and we praise you. And we honor you for this amazing day that you have blessed. And we bless you, oh God, for this sovereign opportunity that I have to sit and to talk to this audience. And this audience got an opportunity to listen to me. And we understand that this is really not a conversation in between me and them, but it's a conversation in between you and them. And so, Father, I pray that during this time of gathering, during this time of this show, that you will speak a relevant word that will encourage, that will lift, will strengthen, that will uplift the listeners. Lord, we pray for Evangelist Harris. Lord, we understand that earth has no sorrow, that heaven cannot heal. And so I pray, God, that you just touch her, oh God, that you would strengthen her. We thank you for the life and the legacy of her husband and her spouse. She's talked many times of how faithful and how loving he was as a husband. And so we honor you, oh God, for his life and for that love that you showed to us through him. And so, Lord, I pray that you would lift her up, that you will strengthen her. As you do all these things, we'll be so careful to give your name praise, glory, and honor in Jesus' name. And everybody say, thank God. Amen. I am so happy to have this opportunity to be with you. This is the first time. Y'all got to pray with me and for me. This is the first time that I will be in here by myself. Don't got no guests today. It's just me and you. And so before we start talking about what the Lord has laid upon my heart to share with you on today, do me one more favor to go to Evangelist Harris's Facebook page and let her know that you're praying for her, that you're supporting her, that you love what's going on with the Mother's Cry. And while you're on social media, just creep on over to Philip White Facebook page or the Christ Center Church's Facebook page and just let us know that you're being blessed by this vehicle. Encourage her to keep going. Let her know that you see what it is that's going on. I'm always encouraged. One of my deacons, one of my trustee boards, he is a faithful watcher. I don't know how many people are watching the show, but I know I got one person that's watching this show every single week. He always lets me know, Pastor, you're doing a great job. So a shout out to Brother Lewis Hayton. I know he's watching me. I know he's at home in front of his computer. Shout out to you, Doc. I love you with the love of the Lord. And to all the Christ and the Regenerated Church, I love you. I'm in the studio today by myself, just me and my main man, Kevin Brown, who's on the ones. He's the guy who makes sure that we go from camera to camera, from set to set. He's got the music playing. He's got them claps. He's got the little soft stuff that's going on behind. And the faithful one of God who is here every single week, Sister Dorothy Herzog. These are great people that you never see that behind the cameras that's on the side, but they are part of the great and awesome ministry that is A Mother's Cry. So it's just me and them. They ain't gonna come on camera, but they're gonna say amen to me in the studio, and they're gonna help me get through. I really wanna talk to you for a few seconds about what the Lord, well, we got more in a few seconds, but I wanna talk to you today what the Lord has laid up on my heart. We have been talking at the Regenerated Church about the discourse that is called the Sermon on the Mount. The Sermon on the Mount. This is the discourse that Jesus teaches in Matthew chapter 5, Matthew chapter 6, and Matthew chapter 7. Matthew 5, 6, and 7 is what we now know to be the Sermon on the Mount. Never asked you to get your Bible, but if you had your Bible and you flip it, you would see that passage of Scripture has nothing but red. It is the teachings of Jesus that we have now comprised, and theologians now call this the Sermon on the Mount. Most people, or many people, VBS, Sunday school, those type of things have taught you the Sermon on the Mount, even though you might not know it's the Sermon on the Mount. The Sermon on the Mount has different parts that resonate with us. And people who do not even worship Jesus as Lord and believe that he is Lord of their life, they hold on to the teachings of the Sermon on the Mount. You know, the Sermon on the Mount, the Beatitudes. Blessed is the poor in spirit, and blessed are they that hunger and thirst. Blessed are the meek, and blessed, and blessed, and blessed. The eight Beatitudes, these are the things that should be your attitudes. Those are the Sermon on the Mount. You are the salt of the earth, and you are the light of the world. That's the Sermon on the Mount. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added to you. That's the Sermon on the Mount. When you pray, And when you fast and when you give, you guessed it, that's the Sermon on the Mount. The Lord's Prayer, I know whether you know it or not, it's a part of the Sermon on the Mount. Our Father, which art in heaven, you know it, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil, for thine is the power, the kingdom, and the glory forever. You guessed it. That's the Sermon on the Mount. The story of the two people that build their house. One builds his house upon the rock, and the other one builds his house upon the sand. Both of those are Sermon on the Mount. And so the Bible says that Jesus teaches in Matthew chapter 5, Matthew chapter 6, and Matthew chapter 7. And when he gets through with this teaching, the Bible says that the people were amazed because he taught as one that had authority, not like the scribes and the Pharisees. And so at the end, we're blessed by the sermon. But this morning, I want to briefly talk to you about the blessings of the beginning of the sermon. Because if you look at your Bible, the Bible tells us in the book of Matthew chapter 5, verses 1 and 2, and seeing the multitude, Jesus went up into the mountain, and when he was set, his disciples came unto him, and he opened his mouth and taught them, saying, one more time, let's do it again. And Jesus, seeing the multitude, went up into the mountain, and when he was set, his disciples came unto him, and he opened his mouth and he taught them, saying, third time is the charm, so you can get it, so you can see the points. And Jesus, seeing the multitude, went up into the mountain, and when he was set, his disciples came unto him, and he opened his mouth, and he taught them, saying. I want to talk this morning about let's get it started. Let's get it started. I submit to you that probably that if I was Jesus, I would have handled things probably a little different than what he did. The text tells us that Jesus sees the multitude. Jesus sees the multitude. And we are shocked because Jesus's ministry always had the multitude attached to it. There was always a multitude of people. Wherever Jesus was, there was multitude. He's different than you and I because you and I are always trying to gather the multitudes. We're trying to get as many Facebook friends as we got. We want to get a multitude. We don't want many dollars. We don't want a few dollars, but we want a multitude of dollars because we believe the more the merrier. We're not satisfied with just one car. We want multiple cars. We need weekend cars. And so Jesus, when you look at his life, he's not like most pastors who's struggling and always trying. Jesus had such an awesome and amazing and dynamic ministry that there was always multitudes around him. Why? Matthew 4 tells us that when people came to him, Jesus had the power and the anointing of the Holy Spirit upon him, that whatever issues that they had, he had the power to break the strongholds of God upon his life. And so if you came sick, you left well. If you came depressed, you left uplifted. If you came and you were confused, you left with a clear path of your direction. Because anytime you came to Jesus and you had an issue, you always left different. We say at our church that you won't leave like you came in Jesus' name. Jesus was like a good roach motel, as I say all the time. Problems check in, but they don't check out. So Jesus, his fame begins to spread because anybody who comes to him, whether you're lame or whether you're sick or whether you're depressed or whether you're down or whether you got a short arm, whether you got high blood pressure or low blood pressure, he first teaches us the fact that he has the power to heal whatever it is that you're going through. Good God from Zion. Somebody here can be encouraged because whatever you're facing, whatever you're up against, whatever problem you have, it might be too hard for man, but it's not too hard for God. I hear God saying, is there anything too hard for God? And so Jesus is the first man that walks the face of this earth that there is nothing too hard for him. And so John says that they come, Matthew in chapter 4 says, and they come and he heals not some, not a few, but the Bible says he heals them all. And as a result of that, every place he goes, there is always a multitude. He would do something for one person. He would tell them, don't tell it. But because God had done something so great with on the inside, they couldn't keep it to themselves. And so they would go to the villages, and they would go to their kindred, and they would go to their fellow men. And they would say, as the woman at the well says, come see a man. And so when we get to Matthew chapter 5, the Bible says that Jesus has what very few of us will ever get in this life. He has a multitude. He's got one service, and one service has turned into two services, and two services have turned into three services. He's got the main campus. He's got the overflow. Every place Jesus goes, there is always a crowd, because the power of God that is on his life causes him to have him a multitude. But he's different than you and I, because when we get a multitude, oftentimes the multitude becomes our master. Jesus knows that you and I need to be trying to learn is the fact that the multitude is really, at the end of the day, y'all, just the multitude. The word multitude is the combination of the word multi and attitudes. It's just a collection of people. Doesn't mean they're integral. It doesn't mean that they have character. It doesn't mean that they're going to stick with you always. The multitude is just the multitude. And Jesus knows, and he will find out as he goes through his ministry, that the multitude is kind of with you one day, talk with me, y'all, and they're against you the next day. One day they're crying Hosanna, and the next day they're crying Crucify Him. Many of us have been hurt because we had the multitude, and we thought that the multitude spoke to character, and the multitude spoke to friendship. And whenever you got in trouble, you found out that the multitude was really, come on, just the multitude. Have you ever thought you had a whole lot of friends, and then you got sick? And when you got sick, you found out that you really didn't have as many friends as you thought you had. Have you ever gone to jail, and before you went to jail, somebody said, if you're ever in trouble, call me, man. And then when you went to call them, your number went straight to voicemail. Jesus knew what you and I are learning, that the multitude is not really the sign of how many people you truly have with you, because the multitude is many, but there are few and far in between that's really going to stick with you. I think about 1,200 Facebook friends, but they just Facebook friends. They ain't real friends, because I understand that true friends, true brothers, true sisters, true disciples are few and far in between. And so the Bible says that Jesus deals with the multitude like the multitude. And I love what he does, because the text says that when he sees the multitude, he goes up into the mountain. Now that's different than what I would have done, because if I would have had a multitude, I wouldn't have moved from the multitude. There is a saying that most of us have, that if it ain't broke, why fix it? If it's not broken. So if something is working, you don't change from where it is. But Jesus knows that there is no integrity in a multitude. Jesus knows that there is no real character in the multitude. And so he's not bound to the multitude. And I want to encourage somebody today who won't make a move because of the crowd, who won't make a move because of your friends, who won't make a move because of your family and because of the voices that are speaking into your head. You've got to learn to tune your heart to the word of God and the spirit of God. And in spite of what the multitude is saying, when God says, make a move, my brother, when God says, make a move, my sister, you got to learn, as they say in the street sometimes, you got to learn how to bust a move. I'm talking to a pastor who has a board that's trying to control him. I'm talking to a wife who has a whole lot of friends that are telling her that she wouldn't put up with that. I'm talking to a young person that's in the schoolyard and got some crazy people telling you to do some crazy things. You got to learn to tune your heart to the word of God. And when God says, make a move, You got to learn how to make a move. Right there in Mother's Cry Land, just say, I got to make a move. And so the text says that Jesus sees the multitude, and then he makes a move. Now, I love him because he has the strength to make a move. But the second thing he has to do that's stronger than what I would have done, he doesn't try to take everybody with him. Because that's the thing that most of us will do. Either we will stay where the multitude is, we'll stay with everybody, or if we decide to move, we try to take everybody with us. And here's a real quick life lesson. Everybody ain't gonna do nothing at all. You just can't get everybody to do everything. And Jesus knows that. So the text tells us that he sees the multitude, he makes a move, and when he makes a move, who comes unto him is his disciple. So there is the move of the master. He doesn't stay with the multitude. He makes his own move. And when he moves, he already knows that when he makes a move, everybody is not going to move with him. I don't know if you live where mountains are, but we're in Los Angeles, we're in California, so there's mountains. And so several times I've traveled up the mountains, and every time I've gone up to the mountains, I've never seen a 4 or 5 lane highway up the mountains. Why is that? Because when you're going up the mountains, usually there's only 1 or 2 lanes because there's not a lot of people that can travel up a mountain. And you've got to learn that in your life, that as you're moving upward, as you're moving in the obedient path that God would have you on, everybody is not going to go. Sometimes your mama's not going to go. Sometimes your brother's not going to go. Sometimes your sister's not going to go. Sometimes your best friend is not going to go. But if God has told you to make a move, you got to learn how to make that move. And so the Bible says Jesus makes the move in spite of the multitude. He makes the move knowing that when he made the move, that the multitude wasn't going to make the move with him. There was some people that was probably down on the bottom of the mountain and said, "Lord, or wherever you go, I'm going to go with you." But when he made the move, they remembered that they had some food at home that they needed to go and take care of, and they couldn't go with him. And so Jesus, the Bible says, he makes the move in spite of the multitude, knowing that at the end of the day, he won't end up with the multitude, because the text says that when he is set, what he has is those that come to him that are now called his disciples. Real quickly, what are disciples? Disciples are the followers, the disciplined followers of another, those that are connected to another teacher. And so once he makes the move, he weeds through the casual. He weeds past the uncommitted, and all he ends up with those that are disciplined and those that are dedicated to his teaching. I dare you to make a move. And when you make a move, you'll truly see who's with you. I dare you to make a move. You'll truly see who's devoted. I dare you to make a move. You'll truly see who are the committed followers of the vision and the plan that God has upon your life. Jesus makes a move. And when he makes a move, what he has is his disciples. Not only does it talk about the move of the master, but this text talks about the move of the multitude. Because the Bible says that once he moves, who comes unto him is his disciples, which means that after Christ made a move, there were those that were connected to his word, connected to his power, that recognized that I'm not going to stay down here at the bottom of the mountain. If Christ is moving to the top of the mountain, that wherever he leads me, I'm going to follow him. And so the Bible says that they make a break. They break from the crowd. They break from the norm, and they see Jesus moving. And when Jesus moves, come on, they move with him. Are you stuck with the crowd? Are you stuck with the people that came only so far, but you see God moving more? Are you more bound or committed to them than you are to Christ? The Bible says that when he gets set, who comes to him is his disciples, his disciples. Now, there are two things the disciples have to do before we go to break. The first thing they have to do is they have to break with the familiar. They have to break with the familiar. At home, repeat that to me. Say, you got to break with the familiar. If you're going to follow Christ, you got to at some time or another break with your comfort zone. Multitude means I came to Christ and all of my buddies came. I came and it was the family church. I came and we all went to the crusade. But at some point or another, Christ is going to challenge you to break with the familiar. There's going to be a call upon your life. There's going to be a mandate that's going to fall upon your life that's going to cause you to have to break with the familiar. And you're going to have to make a decision. Am I more comfortable with being here or am I more comfortable with being in God's will? Can I encourage somebody today that no matter how uncomfortable you might think it be, no matter how much you have to follow God without being able to know where God is going, to follow him, to chase him, even though you cannot trace him. That's what I'm talking about. To follow his thoughts, even though you don't know his ways. At some time or another, you've got to break from that is familiar to follow after the master. Not only did they break with the familiar, but I love it because they had to follow him further. The text says that he went up to the mountain, and when he was set. That means they're following him up the mountain. And as they're following him up the mountain, I'm sure that many of them thought this was a good place for us to stop, but Jesus kept walking. I'm sure some of them, as they were going up the mountain, they saw a good shade tree that would have been a good place for them to set up to listen to his teaching, but Jesus kept walking. I'm sure that some of them thought that where he stopped wasn't a good place, but they weren't the ones that were in control. He was the one in control, and as long as he kept walking, they had to keep walking. And wherever he made a turn, they had to keep making a turn. And when you are with Christ, when you're following Christ, I'll guarantee you, you're going to have to follow him further. It's going to cost you more than what you thought it was going to cost. There's a saying I have at the church all the time that it's always going to cost you more than they advertise on the commercial. Have you ever noticed that commercials always try to give you the lowest price? They tell you it's going to be $12.99. Well, you know it's not going to be $12.99 because it's going to be $12.99 plus tax. Tax going to be added on to that. They don't tell you the fact it's going to be shipping it and handling. They're going to tell you that it's going to be a processing fee. And so you think it's only $12.99, but when you get done, it's around $15 or $16. It's going to cost more than the commercial. And following Christ is going to cost you more. You're going to have to not only follow him, but you're going to have to follow him further. So Jesus makes a move, wants to release this great and awesome teaching, but he can't give it to everybody. He can't take everybody with him. And so Christ makes a move. When he gets through making a move, his disciples, those that have been amongst the multitude, but they believe that there is a divine connection with Christ, they begin to follow him. They break with that is familiar. They follow him further. And the Bible says, as we come back from break, he opens his mouth and he begins to teach them, saying. Go take a break. We'll be right back with Matthew chapter 5, verses 1 and 2. See you in a second. Hey everybody, Pastor Philip White from the Christ Center Church. Every time I shoot the regenerated moment, it is always my goal never to fail, to go from beginning to end in one take. And every time I try not to fail, guess what? I do fail. Stammer over my words, forget my lines, mess it up. You don't believe me? Watch this. Come out, enjoy us. Amen, almost. Watch an awesome and amazing, omnipotent, they would always tell me I need to pay Come on, we're going. I want to scream, but I ain't gonna scream. This is Pastor Philip White. Come on. From that, you can clearly see that Pastor White is anything but perfect. But I am so grateful I got an awesome young lady on the other side of this camera by the name of Isis. She tells me, Pastor White, keep going. What I'm gonna do is I'm gonna go in the studio and I'm gonna cut out all the bad parts. And I'm gonna glue the good stuff together, and at the end of the day, you're gonna look better than what you actually are. In life, it's just like that. And we try to do marriage in one take. We try to raise our kids in one take. We try to love our family members in one take, but all of us gotta be honest, we got some bloopers there. But we don't have an Isis behind the camera of life, but we have an Almighty. And what he does is he cuts out all the bad parts. He cuts out all the mess, all the sin, all the faults, and all the failures. And he puts those things together, and we come out looking better than what we actually are. Psalms 103 talks about the editing process of God, for it simply says, bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Why are you blessing him? Because what he does is he forgives all of my iniquities. He cleanses all of my diseases. You got some bloopers in your marriage, bloopers in your job, bloopers in your relationship with your children. Don't sweat the small stuff. The Almighty is behind the camera. And he's going to cut all the bad stuff out that you're going to seem better than what you actually are. This is Pastor Philip White. This has been a regenerated moment. God bless.
Good afternoon. This is Minister Shirley Knight Harris coming to you with the Mother's Strike. I thank you very much for supporting this ministry, but I'm in need of your help. I need to develop a board of director. If you would like to be on the board, please call me at 310-748-0610. Or you may go to my website at eskhm.org. It's very important that in order for us to continue to reach our young people through Mother's Stride, we're on every Thursday from 2 to 3. I need you to call in, and you may call in at 323-965-1600. You may call in. Or you may send your donations in through my post office box. And if you're not sure how to do that, you can reach me on my website or my email. And my email is eskhm@sbcglober.net. This is a nonprofit organization, and you would be able to deduct your donation off of your taxes. And we thank you very much. Again, this is Mother Stry reaching out to mothers and fathers that have lost their children to drugs, incarcerated, being murdered, pimps, prostitution, drug dealers, and so forth, letting you know that God loves you and Jesus died for you. We're on every Thursday from 2 until 3. And thank you very much. Again, this is Minister Shirley Knight Harris.
couple of updates. That was the regenerated moment called bloopers. Each and every one of us have a blooper in our lives, something in which we wish we could cut out, we could edit. And when I'm shooting in the studio, or when I'm doing the regenerative moment, I always make bloopers. See, there was one right there. But there's this great and awesome young lady that's behind. She always tells me, just keep going. And what she does is she goes in the studio, she goes with the computers and all that kind of good stuff, and she cuts out all the bad, and she glues them together, and I end up looking better than what I actually am. And that's the way that God does for us. He cuts out all the bad stuff. He cleans up all the mess and the junk, and he glues together the good part, and we come out better than what we were before. So, amen. That's that brand new regenerated moment called bloopers. Also, you saw the plea and the petition of Evangelist Harris. Ask him for your love. Ask him for your support. As you're being blessed by this ministry, tuck in a love gift to that P.O. box. She needs a couple of board members. She just, right now, she definitely needs your prayer and support. So I'm asking you to really make sure that you do that so this woman of God can be encouraged. Amen. Well, we're almost done. We're in Matthew chapter 5, verses 1 and 2. I see y'all shouting me out on Facebook. Love you all with the love of the Lord. Keep it coming. Keep letting somebody know that you're listening to Pastor Philip White on the Mother's Cry. Matthew chapter 5, verses number 1 and 2 says, "And Jesus, seeing the multitude, went up into the mountain. And when he was set, his disciples came unto him. And he opened his mouth and he taught them, saying," we started out talking about the move of the master, how he did not stay down, and he knew that everybody couldn't go up. And when God has a move for your life, you've got to break from the multitude, and you've got to know that you've got to move in spite of the multitude, and you got to move knowing that you probably won't end up with the multitude. After the move of the master, there is the move of the multitude. Because the Bible says that when Jesus is set, who comes to him is disciples. Disciples were a part of the multitude, but they see Jesus moving. And because they are connected and wired to the word that comes out of his mouth and the life change that he has placed on their heart, they move. And they first break with the familiar because they got to move from the multitude, and then they follow him further. Because the text says that when he was set, they came unto him. And then lastly, I want to encourage you from the end clause of that verse number 2, for it says, "And he opened his mouth and he taught them, saying." And he opened his mouth and taught them, saying. He opened his mouth. We understand that when Jesus opened his mouth, what came out of his mouth was his words. Now, Jesus' words were different than your and I words, because when Jesus speaks, he speaks the word of God. The Bible tells us that in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And so Jesus is the Word. And so when he speaks, there is power in his Word. It tells us that the Bible tells us that man cannot live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. And so when he gets into the mountain, he's no longer doing miracles. He's no longer healing bodies, but he does the most important part that we need as regenerated believers, is that we need to tone our hearts and spirits to the word of God. So those that go up higher are coming away from the fish and the loaves. They're coming away from healing and give me a house and give me a car and I need a boyfriend or I need a wife. But really what they are tuned into is they are in tuned unto the word of God. How do you know a disciple? He is attentive to the words of his master. David says in Psalms 119, "Wherewithal shall a young man cleanse his ways, but that he cleave unto the word of God." He further goes on that says that thy word is a lamp unto my feet, and it's a light unto my path. He says that thy word have I hidden in my heart, that I might not sin against you. Disciples, different than multitude. Multitude is there for what you can give me and what you can do for me. But disciples understand that if I don't have a word from God, and all I need is a word from God, and everything will change in my situation and circumstance. I might not have a job, but if I got a word, I know things gonna be all right. I might have cancer, but if I got a word from God, everything is going to be all right. And the Bible says, and Jesus, when his disciples, his discipline, his followers, his connected people come, he gives them that that nobody can take away and that nobody can give. He opens his mouth. My God, I love it when I'm in a situation and circumstance and God opens his mouth. I don't want what's in his hand. I want what's coming out of his mouth. And what's coming out of his mouth, I believe, is always better than with his hand. He opens his mouth and he begins to teach them. Can I tell you that if you're in a church, find you a church that's teaching the word of God. That I know music is good. I know it's good to have a good air condition. I know you want children's church for your kids. I know you want a good parking spot. It needs to be a good time so you can see the ball game. But none of that matters if once you get there, the word of God is not preached. Because where the word is, there is deliverance. Where the word is, strongholds are broken. Where the word is, marriages are renewed and restored and things are brought into order. I don't know about you, but I cannot live without the word of God. And Jesus says to those that will follow, those that will break from the familiar, I got a special blessing for you. Here is my word. I'm trying to get from this point, but later on, the Bible says that Jesus begins to teach. And when he teaches, the multitude gets upset with his teaching and they leave him. And he looks at his disciples, the same two connections, multitude versus disciples. And he says unto his disciples, will you leave us also? The Bible says that Peter answers and says, Lord, where shall we go? And to whom shall we turn? For you have the words of eternal life. Disciples, different from the multitude, are not there for what you can do for me, but the words that come out of your mouth. And the Bible says that when he opens his mouth, he begins to teach them. He begins to teach them. And that's an interesting word, the word teach, because the word teach is to discipline and to grow and to structure and to give order to. It is the difference in between my kids and them bad kids that's down the street. It's the difference in between your lawn and the lawn of them people down the street is that their lawn or your child has been taught. There's an amazing difference in between the taught, come on y'all, and the untaught. Have you ever been in the mall and seen a child that was all over the place climbing on top of stuff, screaming and hollering, his mama couldn't control him. I get nervous because my mama had the 3-0 rule. Come on, y'all know it. Don't touch nothing. You know it. Don't ask for nothing because guess what? You ain't going to get nothing. Going into the store, we knew how to act. Why? Because we had been taught. Before we went to folks' house, my mama would tell you, you can get over there and act a fool if you want to. Where you show out, I'm going to show out. Y'all know y'all had a mama just like mine. And so our behavior was different because we were taught. And things will grow wild and they will be out of control, but they are to come under the words and the teaching and the training of the master. And you can always tell the difference in between them. And the difference and distinction is one has been taught and the other one has not. And so Jesus wants his disciples not just to be crazy folks that's saying they love God, but living all any old kind of way. That's worshiping on one day and smoking weed on the other. That's deacons at church, but then they're derelicts on their job. That they preacher in church, but they pervert it when they get home. He doesn't want that to be associated with his name. So he opens his mouth and his word that his people might be taught, that they might conduct themselves in the way that they should conduct themselves, that they might know how to act when trials and tribulations can come, when they might know how to act where they would honor God with their dimes and with their dollars. May they know how to act when the devil would come, when they know how to act that they might build up their homes on the sure and firm foundation. Jesus wants disciples that he can be proud of, just like my mama, that they know how to be taught. So the Bible says, Jesus sees the multitude. He goes up into the mountain. And when he is set, his disciples come to him and he opens his mouth and he begins to teach them. He begins to teach them. Teach them about life. Teach them about the Beatitudes, the structure of how their attitudes to be. Chapter 5, he gives them their identity. He gives them the antonyms, or the antithesis, excuse me. I know you've heard it said in the old days, but let me tell you now how things should be. He teaches them that when you pray, when you fast, and when you give, he teaches them to seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added. He teaches them that when there is an argument in between you and a brother, to lay your gift at the altar and go back and to make reconciliation with them and then come back and pick up your gift. Jesus wants disciples that men might be able to see their good works and glorify the Father which is in heaven. And so he breaks from the multitude, goes up into the mountain. They'll come after him. And when they come after him, he gives them that only he can. He begins to open his mouth and he begins to teach them. My brother and my sister, I would that you would hold on to God, that you would follow him, that you would go after him with everything that you can. And when you go after him, you will get a revelation and you will give an awesome and amazing rhema word that will change and charge your life. And the way you know that the word is taking good ground is that it will begin to teach and develop the disciplines of God. You'll begin to see yourself bearing the fruits of the Spirit. Not that you're shouting on Sundays, but you got more joy. You got more peace. You got more self-control. Don't you want your Christianity to be more than the profession that comes out your mouth? Don't you want people to tell you you're a Christian versus you tell them that you're a child of God? That only comes as you continue to follow Christ. You listen to his word and you allow his word to find good ground in your eyes to develop and to bring discipline to you. Let's pray over this word. Father God, we just thank you and we praise you for our time gathering that we've had together. We thank you and we praise you, oh God, that you are not confused by the multitude, because you understand that few are the followers that are amidst the multitude. And so, Lord, in order to prove and to test who we are, sometimes you make a move. And when you make a move, it's for us to follow the moves that you make. Lord, we understand that as your disciples, it's going to cause us to break with the familiar. And then, Lord, all of us can testify that we've had to follow you a whole lot further than what we ever thought. We've had to follow you through bad times and through good times, through tough times, through losses and through gains. But we say, as David says, yea, though I walk through the valley and the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Lord, we know that when you said, and when we come unto you, you will open your mouth and you'll begin to teach us, Lord. You'll begin to teach us that we might grow. Teach us that we might be disciplined. Teach us that we might be in self-control, that we might bear fruit, and that we might be able to give your name praise and glory in our actions and in our lives. We pray and ask, oh God, that we begin to continue to grow in you. This is our prayer in Jesus' name. And everybody who knows that you're growing in God, say thank God. Amen. For those of you that are listening to me that do not know the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ and the pardon of your sins, I pray that you will surrender your heart and your minds and your will to him, that as the Spirit is convicting and calling you closer to him, that you will not resist him, but that you will repent of your sins, confess him as Lord, and he will come in and abide with you. After you've done that, I want to encourage you to find a great and awesome and wholesome integral church in which you can learn the word of God, you can grow and develop in the things of God, and you watch God bless you real good. I always encourage you, if you don't have a church home and you're in the Los Angeles area, you can always come and be with us at the Regenerated Church. We reside at 10525 South Avalon in the city of Los Angeles, California. Our services are at 8:30 on Sunday mornings and 11:30 on that Sunday afternoon. Wednesday night, 6:30 is prayer, and 7 o'clock is our midweek Bible study. Continue to keep praying for me. Continue to keep praying for evangelist Shirley Knight Harris. Here in the studio today with Dr. Kev and Sister Dorothy. We love each and every one of you with the love of the Lord. Until next week, this is A Mother Cry. Be blessed.